start reading what they're about. I'm like, I need this, and I need this, and I need this. And I'm like, devotional, I can do that. 15, 20 minutes. Yeah, I got that. Good morning. I'm being waved at in the back. We're being recorded, so, you know, everybody appropriate church-like behavior. I'm just kidding. Yes. Just kidding. Good morning.
Howdy.
Welcome to everybody this morning in a cold, blustery Sunday morning. So I'm actually going to steal a scripture this morning, or I guess not steal. I'm going to repurpose a scripture this morning that Tim shared on Wednesday that really struck with me. It's from Psalm 65. And it said, thou crownest the year with thy goodness, and thy paths drop with fatness. And it just really struck me that he crowns the year. And so I've been praying every morning, Lord, crown this day with your goodness. Crown the day.
Yes.
And it just, every morning in my car, I can't help but think that he is just looking down at this day. And he's placing his power and his authority
yes.
and his goodness.
Yes.
Crown the day with your goodness, Lord. Crown the day with your goodness, Lord. Crown the day with your goodness.
Amen.
And the fatness just flows in our paths. It really struck me Wednesday. And so I encourage you guys to just focus and say, Lord, crown the day.
Amen.
And then, so Jody got a new devotional. Her son got her a new a devotional for Christmas. And so, of course, I had to buy one. So I went online to buy one and bought three. And so I want to share this morning, and I know that this is probably not new information, but I just knew that there was a nugget in here for us this morning. So I'm going to share from day one of Glorious Grace. And it says, grace is a person. Let's see. Others, so he's talking about people of all walks of life all over the world are finding freedom from their long-term conditions, addictions, and bondages. They share joyfully with us how the Lord supernaturally delivered them from the long-term panic attacks, substance abuse, and from decades of depression.
Come on.
Others write in, brimming with thanksgiving because God has restored their marriages,
yeah.
has, excuse me, has healed their relationships with their estranged children,
yes.
Yes.
and has healed their bodies when the doctor had given them no hope.
Yes.
Rita,
yes.
Tammy, I don't know if Tammy remembers, but we prophesied. Three miraculous births. We've had one,
yes.
we've had two, and Rita, I believe you're number three.
Come on.
We are seeing the fruits of a relationship
yes.
with grace. The person
yes.
of grace, Jesus
yes.
Christ. And he can use, I wish I could read all of them to you because you will notice that there is one common thread we've run through all of these letters. And we have our own testimonies in this house. And there is one common denominator that tipped these people from defeat
yeah.
into victory, from breakdowns into breakthroughs, that
yes.
they all had an encounter with Jesus Christ.
Yes.
They all caught a revelation of
yes.
his grace.
Yes.
My dear friend, the grace revolution begins with Jesus Christ.
Yes.
We are in revolution right now.
Yes.
We are seeing
yes.
the victory
Lord.
Of revolution being
yes.
won
Lord.
Over the
yes.
kingdom of darkness.
Yes.
It's not a movement. It's not a teaching. It's not a subject to be studied. It's a person.
Yes.
Yes.
What you believe about this person makes all the difference.
Jesus.
I'm sure you've heard about Jesus and are familiar with his name. You may have even attended Sunday school as a child, heard all the Bible stories about him. The question is, do you know Jesus personally?
Yes,
that is
it.
What changes
yes,
everything.
Right.
Is he a historical figure? Is he a prominent Jewish rabbi? Or a son, or simply the son of a Galilean carpenter? Who is he to you? Is he just another teacher or is he your savior?
Yes.
Whatever adversity, challenge, or circumstances you may be faced with today, your answer is found in the person of Jesus. Today, there is a grace revolution sweeping across the globe because the person of Jesus is boldly preached, proclaimed, and lifted high.
Amen.
This is what the grace revolution is all about. It's about your life touched, changed, and transformed from the inside out. It's about living a victorious life,
yes.
a life that wins, a life that reigns triumphant over defeat, failure, and frustration.
Yes.
When you encounter the person of grace, see his heart of love for you, and then the veil of Christian religion is removed, and there's no turning back.
That's right.
You'll begin to step away from defeat and take massive leaps towards your victory.
Yes.
Now, on Wednesday, December 28th, I stood up here and I said, I read from Joshua, and 3 days we're taking the land. Now, how many of you know a day with the Lord is 1,000 years? He doesn't measure time like we do. But I was thinking, January 1st was day one, right? Wednesday, January 4th, day two. Sunday, January 8th, day three. It's time for us to take the land. This is the third day. This is the birth. This is our third miraculous birth today, I believe. Today. I know, Mike, you posted about a false start. Some people had such high hopes when we turned the calendar, and things haven't changed yet. Well, I'm telling you, now is the time. Now is the time. We've heard things. You know, Michael and I were talking this morning. Be ready. Be ready, because you're going to see some things that are going to make you go, what? But, you know, greater is he who is in us than he who is in this world. And I'm telling you, he who is in this world is going, uh-oh.
Yep.
They know grace. They understand grace. They have a revelation of grace. They are grace. And he cannot stand in the presence of the grace of Jesus Christ. So I want us to know, without a doubt, that the Lord has crowned the year with his goodness. We will take the fat of land. We will live in houses we did not build. We will eat from the vineyards we did not plant. And the joy of the Lord is ours. And it is our strength in Jesus' name. In Jesus' name.
In his image. Yes. So each day, if you just focus on him and that relationship,
know that you're Rick, because we're individuals. But when we're focused on that image and we're still one.
Yes.
We are in one accord because you're Jesus, I'm Jesus, she's Jesus. I mean, we're all Jesus. So like you said, we are in one mind and one accord. So if we're focusing on that image and focusing on just one day to just live the life that he's giving you, don't worry about being perfect. Don't worry about what's going on around you. Just what you're here for, we are in one mind and one accord. So when you're focused on that, you don't have to spend 3 hours. You can't just do, because that's just what he did.
That's all, yeah. Never heard.
Two things. One, kind of like based on what you were saying about the three birds, emphasize that. You know, I talked to Mike about it before. I remember telling him once that I love when Rita manifests basically what her spirit is feeling.
Yes.
And there's some bands. Celebrate the three wise.
woke up in the dream and I said, just to know that my kids, my grandkids, can have a Christmas pageant at school, or that we can mention Almighty God. You know. And he looked at me and he said, it's coming. And I woke up and I thought, who was that person? And it took me quite a while laying there until I realized that's who it was. Now, obviously, I wouldn't know him from anything. He didn't look like it was, but I knew in the dream after I woke up that that's who it was. And so I don't know what's going on, but we've all prayed. I know nothing about Donald Trump. I don't know anything about him. But I know this. He's going to be our president. Mm-hmm. We need to support him, do what we can, pray that God will use him and the people coming in to turn this thing back to our Constitution and to the reality. You know, I believe everybody can believe what they want to believe. You know, but do we have to say that we're not a Christian nation just to appease them when 90% of this population is Christian?
Right.
I mean, we welcome them to come here and they can practice their religion, but we don't have to change our entire way of life to accommodate them.
Exactly.
And Jane and I were talking, and I will shut up, but we were talking this morning about, they said there are so many suicides by servicemen coming back from over in the Middle East. And, you know, they just can't hardly explain it. And this guy heard voices, you know, that shot up down in Florida, killed 5 people, wounded 8. And I told Jane, I said, they are dealing with the Prince of Persia.
Yes.
They're going
they
into
are.
His home court.
Yes,
and
are.
We can't even have our people tell them about Jesus. So we need to pray for those servicemen. They
right.
are encountering
right.
demonic powers
yes.
everywhere.
Yes, exactly.
And if you're not covered with the blood,
right.
you're fair
right.
game.
Right. Right.
So these people are getting exposed to that stuff and don't even know what's happening to
right.
them.
Right.
But if you think that's not true, look at the chaos in that part of the world.
Right.
Utter horrible
yes.
beheadings and disemboweling and things that are beyond our imagination. And we wonder, how is that possible? Because that is a demonic stronghold
yes.
there.
Right.
Yes,
and yet, isn't it straight?
Yes.
No.
They can't get into Israel.
That's right.
Right.
Why is that? Because Almighty God said no. That is sacred ground.
Yes.
Right. Amen.
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 Yeah.
As most of you know, I've been dealing with this leg for 6 months, and the other day, Friday, I had 2 doctor's appointments, one with podiatry and one with vascular. And a week ago, vascular did a surgery to shut down one vein so more blood would flow to the wound. Well, Friday I was supposed to see them both, and they're both in the same building because the Holy Spirit told me to change the doctors. And when I went in there, or the night before I went in there, I had so much pain trying to sleep and everything, which is, you know, I gotta say in the past 6 months, it hasn't been anything new. But I'm thinking, you know, what is tomorrow gonna bring? What are these doctors, are they gonna give me more? Scraping, cleaning, and put me in more pain, and you know, and they don't do that intentionally. I know it's the knockdown infection and et cetera. But anyways, Thursday night, I'm laying in bed, and I'm just like, sometimes just screaming at the top of my lungs at the devil, and saying, you know, you have no place here. I am not going to accept this pain, and all of a sudden, forgive me, but I'm thinking, who was it that stepped out of the boat? And I'm asking, laying there, and I'm asking the Lord, and he said, Peter. And he said, that's what you're doing right now. You need to step out of the boat. And the next day when I went people, podiatry, and they took off the bandage and they said, "This looks great." You know, it's really gotten smaller in a week's time. And they contributed that to shutting down one of the veins so more blood flow goes to the wound. And then I went upstairs and to the vascular, and he says to me, we did the ultrasound and everything, and the vein is still shut down, it's doing good. Podiatry said it looks good. He said, "I'll see you in 2 months.
Come on."
And I was thinking, you know, before he even said it, I was thinking that I was going to see both these doctors in 2 weeks. And he said, "No, 2 months." And he said, "When I see you," he said, "you'll be dancing."
Praise the Lord.
Yeah. So I was just so blessed because there is an end sight.
Yeah.
You know? And I needed to hear that. And the Holy Spirit knows I needed to hear that. And I just, I went down to my vehicle and I was just thanking God for, you know, the decision that I made. And this time they didn't put any stuff on the wound at all. They just kind of put dry stuff on. I have nurses that come like 3 times a week. And now they said after that doctor's appointment, they're only going to come twice a week. And basically, that's it. You know, I looked at it, I was surprised. Basically, probably that surgery with the vein has done. And as I'm saying this, I'm thinking, whose blood is it? Who's gonna stop the flow?
Amen.
You know, the enemy tries to stop the flow. So I have pain. And since the surgery, I've had pain, but nowhere near what it was.
Mm-hmm.
So,
thank you, Jesus.
You know, I was talking to Jody earlier. It's like, you know, sometimes after all this time, I get into that mindset of why me? Why do I got to go through this all by myself? And I'm just tired of it. I'm just tired of, I want to go back to work. I want to drive. And I can't, and I'm just thinking, you know, why me? And this voice, I know it's the Holy Spirit probably says, don't go there.
Yeah.
You know, just keep focused.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I forget who said it, but when he said, keep your focus on Jesus,
yeah.
You know, keep
right.
Keep praising him, because this end is, the end is near.
Yes.
Amen.
For this sickness.
Yes.
Amen.
Amen.
Thank
you, Lord.
Amen.
Thank you, Lord. Anyone else? James?
The same thing goes for trying to die. I hear so many people dwell on a negative word. People would focus on what's positive and not ponder other people. We wouldn't have to strive as far. So we're a team this way. I'm supposed to encourage people to do that, but that's what we got to do more of. We can't go into the dying on better than this stuff and this pride, and we can't see enough. We gotta really put, what was it, a breastplate of righteousness
mm-hmm.
on in this part of that.
I was thinking while Don was talking, you know, my job is to work with local governments. I'm in schools, I'm in cities, I'm in counties, I'm in state offices, and I'm transitioning a bunch of new clients, and had a meeting this week in a school where the conversation turned to, they had a student that they weren't sure if it was an accident or committed suicide. There's this they're cutting their circulation off, like hangings or nooses or something. I don't know. The kids come up with these things that they're just evil to experiment. It was middle school, junior high age kid, and was killed. His name was Sean. So remember Sean's family. But there's opportunities, even in the circumstances where, you know, even in schools that aren't allowed to have a Christmas program, we can have a meeting with the superintendent and we can pray. You know, like there are opportunities everywhere.
Amen.
And, you know, I have to be careful, you know, but opportunities present themselves.
Yes.
The beginning of a meeting, at the end of a meeting, when, you know, it's not in a formal setting. And, you know, there are people everywhere. Even if we can't do a billboard, if they can't have a program, there are people in our schools that care deeply for these children. And there is a spirit after these young, the next generation is battling a spirit of suicide that is ridiculous. And I just rebuke that right now in Jesus' name for our young people. Yeah.
There again, not to be redundant or whatever, the highest form of worship is a life lived.
Mm-hmm.
And you can even do that without even speaking.
Yeah.
You know, when you're being mistreated, or when, you know, they're not doing you fair at work, or you're having to work beside somebody you don't really particularly care for, and you do all things with thanksgiving, mm-hmm. when you're not grumbling and complaining when it seems there's a way that seems right to man, you think, I have every right to complain, but you don't,
mm-hmm.
they look at you and they're wondering, why are they not complaining? It's joy unspeakable. Why are they always happy?
Yeah.
When you're focused on who he is and what he's done, and don't worry about everything else, your very life lived.
Amen.
Will open up those opportunities, because they're going to ask you, how come?
Yeah.
You can do this
right.
without complaining. How come every day they're on your case and you don't say anything negative? How come? And as the world gets more chaotic, and it will, and more dark, and it will, we're going to see brighter, and they're going to be more drawn to us.
That's right.
And that's how
it's
going to be like wildfire.
That's right.
Yeah, and that whole conversation started with, I just asked, I said, what's the young person's name?
Mm-hmm.
So I can pray for his family. That's how the whole conversation started.
Yeah.
And you just never know. I just said, what's his name? I want to pray for him and his family. And, Mike.
I want to thank everybody for giving me the opportunity to go to North Carolina and see my kids. It's a very, very, it's unspeakable words. I don't have the time to go through everything, but God is the God of restoration. He manifested Isaiah 49. Where he said, I will contend with those who contend with you, and your children will save. I'm basically restored back to all my kids now. After 1991, I just want to thank God for his mercy and his grace, and his timetable, because it was a picture being put back together that had to take some time to take the wounds and heal them. Before more growth started happening and stuff, and it's been awesome. I just want to thank you. It's going to take probably months to reveal all the things that have happened down there, but he's broken chains, and my son and my daughter at 2 o'clock on New Year's morning, we were out of the bonfire, just breaking every chain. We probably woke everybody up in the house, but we didn't care. So anyway, I thank you all for coming for me. Thank you.
Such a story of hope and redemption. Mike waited 26 years for reconciliation with his children, but God is faithful.
Jesus,
God is faithful.
Glory.
It is very encouraging. Yeah. Anyone else this morning? All right, let's stand and go to the Lord this morning.
Yes.
Heavenly Father, we thank you. We thank you for the victories, Lord. We thank you, Lord, that you have introduced yourself, the person of grace, into our lives and invited us in to have a relationship, to know you, and to be like you, Lord. We just thank you, Lord, that when you come and renew our minds, when we put on the mind of Christ, Lord, all things are possible. All things are possible, Lord, when we come together in one mind, in one accord, in you, Jesus. We thank you for the victories that have already happened, and we look forward to more, Lord. We know that you have more for us. That you prepare the path, Lord. That you light up the way, Lord. That your Holy Spirit lead us and guide us into all victory, Lord. For the lost, Lord, who are searching, who are hurting, Lord. Let those opportunities continue to arise, Lord. And let your voice be heard. Let your hope be felt in the hearts of men and women, Lord. And Lord, we pray for the young generation, Lord. The young people who face a world full of darkness and hate and division, Lord. But we speak light and life and hope. Lord, give them a purpose. Let them know that they are precious, Lord. Raise them up, a new generation. A new generation that knows you, who is not concerned with the old ways, Lord, but are focused on you. Jesus. Jesus. We lift you up here this morning, Lord. We invite you in, Lord, to crown this day with your goodness, to crown this service with your grace and your mercy, Lord. We thank you for the marriages that have been restored. We thank you for the relationships and the children that have been restored. We thank you for the healings, the physical healings in the body that are happening right now. Right now, for those who have a need, right now. And we thank you, Lord, that when we pray in your name, it is done. It is finished. Lord, that our shadows as we pass by heal the sick. That the blind eyes are open, Lord. When these lights that you have placed in our hearts, Lord, when they shine, they give men hope. Lord, let the seekers come forth. Let those who are hungry come forth to be fed. Let those who are thirsty come and drink and never be thirsty again. Oh, we thank you, Lord, that you have lit us up. That you have lit us up, Lord, in the midst of the darkness in this city, in this state, in this nation, in this world. That you have lit us up as a beacon of hope. A beacon of hope that they can come and find the answer they've been looking for. And we know it's you, Lord. It's you, Jesus. To know you, to be received and accepted by you. To become one with you, Lord. We thank you, Lord, that you have knit together this body of believers. You've established this church of promise, this house of prayer, Lord. And we ask for those who are meant to be here, Lord, draw them in from the north and the south and the east and the west. Let them come and feast upon your grace, your glorious grace. We have tasted the first fruits of the revelation of your glorious grace, Lord. But now we ask for the harvest. We ask for the harvest of your grace in this house, in this day, Lord, that you have crowned this day with goodness, Lord. And we thank you and we give all the praise and the honor and glory to you, Jesus, Savior, friend. Be with us this morning. Be with us as we continue to worship. Be with us as we receive your word, as we renew our minds and put on the mind of Christ. Thank you, Lord. Thank you for all that you've done and all that you continue to do. In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. I hope that if you have a need, that you don't leave this place without talking to the Lord. And receiving everything that you need. It is his good pleasure to give good gifts to his children. In Jesus' name.
Hallelujah.
If you haven't brought your cell phone with you today, just a reminder, please turn those ringers off. And this Friday, favorite Friday of the month, Eastern Gatehouse Prayer.
Amen. We're in the starting blocks again, as far as the prayer situation goes. The Lord has a plan. He wants to reveal specific things for this body to not only put her in her full position, but also prepare for us to take this region and this city. Don was talking about revival as in days of old. I saw a picture of Smithton. Peter knows about Smithton, Missouri, where God broke out. And I saw a picture of that church, and the church was this size. And when Holy Spirit fell in that place, and I saw a picture of it here also, that there were people lined up out there, down there, four houses down on 37th Street, waiting to get in because there was service after service. service
yes.
after service.
Yes.
I saw this several years ago, and it's time.
Yes.
It's time. But he's preparing you all
yes.
to be ministers and priests to
yes.
deal with that which is coming in.
Yes.
So don't come in, you know, just expecting to get a little fed, a little this. This is a time of preparation.
Yes.
So don't back off. Soak it in. Many of you had years of God pouring into you that you don't know what to do with. Well, guess what? The time is now coming. Come Friday night, we need to get in unity on what God wants to do. And it's hard to explain what is happening at these Friday night things unless you're here experiencing it. Once you experience it, it'll fill the gaps in on what is going on around yourself. Be a part. Be a part.
Amen. So let's speak the word this morning.
Yes.
Will you not revive us again, that your people may rejoice in you? Yes, Lord. I am a believer, and these signs do follow me. In the name of Jesus, I cast out demons. I speak in new tongues. I lay hands on the sick, and they do recover. Yes, Lord. Christ has redeemed me from the curse of the law. Therefore, I forbid any sickness or disease to come upon this body. Every disease, germ, and every virus that touches this body dies instantly in the name of Jesus. Every organ, every tissue of this body functions to the perfection to which God created it to function. And I forbid any malfunction in this body in the name of Jesus. I receive the spirit of wisdom and revelation in the knowledge of him, the eyes of my understanding being enlightened, and I am not conformed to this world, but am transformed by the renewing of my mind. My mind is renewed by the word of God. Yes. The Lord rebukes the devourer for my sake, and no weapon that is formed against my finances will prosper. All obstacles and hindrances to my financial prosperity are now dissolved. The Lord has pleasure in the prosperity of his servant, and Abraham's blessings are mine. Toby and Don, you two want to come take the offering this morning, please? Toby, can you ask the blessing, please?
Lord, we're thankful to be here today, God. Be with your people and to hear your word. Lord, we just ask that all these words we take in today, God,
yes,
be our ammunition as we head out into the world, Lord. Begin to use it for its proper intents, God,
yes,
to heal the sick,
yes,
to raise the dead,
yes,
God,
yes,
to make your massive move that you have called us here for.
Yes,
we are your children, Lord,
yes,
that you
Lord.
Put here at this specific time, Lord,
yes,
to see your will be performed, God.
Amen.
Lord, we just ask now that you be with us for the remainder of this service, Lord. Bless this offering, bless the gift and the giver. In the mighty name of Jesus we pray.
Amen.
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 Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Praise God. Praise God. Thank you, Jesus. Glory to God. Whom the Son sets free is free indeed. Praise God. Hallelujah. If you have any need here this morning, I mean, come on. The Holy Spirit has moved and is moving. It's just a question of whether you want to receive it, believe it, and accept it. Praise God. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Nobody, it doesn't matter what the need is. It doesn't matter what the situation or circumstance you're faced with. Believe for that manifestation right now. Hallelujah. It is finished. It is done. We just enter into it by faith. Praise God. Give the Lord a hand this morning. Praise God. Praise God. Praise God. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Amen. Amen. God bless you. You may be seated. Amen. She's fine. Hallelujah. We'll just let her come around to her on her own as she feels comfortable with it. Praise the Lord. God is good. Amen. Hallelujah. Being set free. That's what it's all about. Set free from fear. Set free from anxiety. Set free from whatever the enemy is trying to put against you. God has set you free. Thank the Lord. Amen. Give him another praise. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Praise God. Praise God. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. And the Sunday school classes, kids can go downstairs. Hallelujah, Jesus. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Lord. Hallelujah. Praise God.
Oh, thank you, Jesus.
Hallelujah. Jesus said he was going back to the Father so that he could send back the Holy Spirit, the Spirit of Christ or Christ in you, the hope of glory, the eternal Spirit. Hallelujah. Praise God. The disciples didn't understand it at the time, and sometimes we don't understand it even today. It's not important that we understand it, it's just important that we embrace it. It's the means by which God has chosen to minister to his people. Praise the Lord. And hallelujah. However he wants to do it, it's all right with me. Praise God. We'll just get right into the word this morning, and I'd like to start at John chapter 16, verses 5 through 15, and it's appropriate because of what we've seen and experienced here already this morning. And you know, The truth is the truth whether there's manifestation or not. Whether you experience or don't experience it or accept it or don't accept it, that's the reality anyhow. Amen. And so, you know, you take your pick. You can embrace it or you can just go without. I mean, that's up to you. But it's available 24/7 all the time. Has been ever since Jesus was resurrected and sent back the Holy Spirit. It's his means and his way of communicating, of leading us, of guiding us, healing us, delivering us, doing all that God wants for each and every one of us. And it can happen anywhere, anytime, all the time. It's great that we have this in a church service because it helps people to understand maybe a little bit of what God's doing. But it can happen anywhere. It can happen to you driving down the road, walking the dog, I mean, sitting at the kitchen table. I mean, God is here. He's in us. And it's just a questioning of us, you know, acknowledging that and staying focused on that reality instead of all the other peripheral things that are just distractions for the most part. Praise the Lord. So let's go to John chapter 16, beginning at verse 5. But now I go my way to him that sent me, and none of you asketh me, whither goest thou? But because I have said these things unto you, sorrow hath filled your heart. Nevertheless, I tell you the truth. It's expedient for you that I go away. For if I go not away, the Comforter will not come unto you. But if I depart, I will send him unto you. And when he is come, he will reprove the world of sin and of righteousness and of judgment. Of sin because they believe not on me. How many of you know that's sin? We talk about a lot about things that people do, but that's the sin. The sin is not believing in him.
Amen.
Amen. So sin and of righteousness of judgment. Sin because they believe not on me. Righteousness because I go to my Father and you see me no more. Of judgment because the prince of this world is judged. I have yet many things to say unto you, but you cannot bear them now. Howbeit, when he, the Spirit of truth, is come, he will guide you into all truth. For he shall not speak of himself, but whatsoever he shall hear, that shall he speak, and he will show you things to come. He shall glorify me, for he shall receive of mine, and shall show it unto you. All things that the Father hath are mine, therefore said I, that he shall take of mine, and shall show it unto you. Praise the Lord. So the Holy Spirit comes to live in us, God's new temple. Amen. We are individually and corporately places where heaven and earth meet, and that's what we just experienced. Praise the Lord. The Holy Spirit is a gift. Now, I come from a Pentecostal background that you weren't so sure about that fact because it was about you just really doing a lot of stuff in order for God to give it to you. If you're here today and you're a believer in Christ, the Holy Spirit is yours. It's just a question of you yielding to that Spirit. Now, people talk about tongues and so on and so forth. Tongues is just the evidence. It's not the Holy Ghost. It's just evidence of having accepted that and yielded that one member, the most unruly member, to God. Praise the Lord. So I know a lot of times people get all anxious about those things, but praise God. Here is where God comes to the natural world. Praise God. The Holy Spirit's a gift. It's grace. It's the grace of God. It's the Spirit of grace. Jesus, as it was already said here this morning, grace is not a thing, it's a person. And the Holy Spirit is the Spirit of Christ. So he is the Spirit of grace. Amen. He's the Spirit of grace. So let's look at a couple of scriptures here just briefly. Acts chapter 1, verse 8. Ye shall receive power after that the Holy Ghost has come upon you, and ye shall be witnesses unto me both in Jerusalem and all Judea and Samaria and unto the uttermost parts of the earth. Now Acts 2, 38. I haven't used this scripture for a while. Praise the Lord. What the heck? Then Peter said unto them, repent and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ for the remission of sins, and you shall receive the gift of the Holy Ghost. The gift of the Holy Ghost. Repentance is not, you know, just wailing and going on and on. You may do that, but that's not repentance. Repentance is a change of mind. You change your mind about God, about the goodness of God, about the fact that this gospel, the good news, is something that is so unnatural to human way of thinking, so unnatural to religion, that it's the gospel of grace. That it's not about you anymore. It's all about what God has already done and your acceptance of that reality. Baptized in the name of Jesus Christ. Well, look, I'm not going to go down that road right now this morning, but the truth is, that's the only way you're going to get baptized anyway, no matter how the whatever titles are called over you. It's still about Jesus. I and the Father are one. They are one. Three manifestations, one God. Israel even knew that. Israel understood that. That was the thing that separated them from all other tribes and clans and religions and so on and so forth, was the fact that the Shema, you know, it's, "Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God is one." So it's not really, you know, a mysterious theology or something, and it's just a fact. And if you get baptized into Christ, you know, Jesus said you're baptized in the Holy Spirit. Well, how can you not be baptized in the Holy Spirit if you're baptized into Christ?
Yeah.
Now, I'm not saying that, you know, you have to be dipped in water immediately and all that stuff has to happen. I'm talking about a baptism is something where you're immersed in Christ. Christ becomes the thing. I'm not saying you shouldn't be baptized. I'm just saying there is something going on here more than just the physical stuff that we do and then turn into rituals that nobody really understands and just does them without any real consequence, without any real long-term effect.
Right.
Amen? So you receive then the gift of the Holy Spirit. It's a gift. You didn't do anything to earn it any more than you earned salvation. It's something that God wants you to have and experience. Because without it, you are impotent. You are incapable of doing anything that will further the kingdom of God or bless yourself or anyone else. Amen? Jesus lived an amazing life. I'd say that was, you know, pretty obvious, right? Anybody who knows anything about him. But it's important for us to realize Jesus had some help. Jesus operated as a man when he was on this planet. I'm not denying the fact that he was fully God, but he never operated with the power of his independence as God. He operated strictly as a man filled with the Spirit of God. Hallelujah. Amen. Jesus lived this life. And it's important that we need to understand that Jesus did it with the help of the Holy Spirit. He could not have done it otherwise as a man. Power comes from grace. The gospel is the power of God unto salvation. The gospel of grace is the power of God. Not just for salvation. It's sozo. That's everything that is needed comes through grace. Comes by the Spirit. Now, Jesus didn't rely on his own innovation. He didn't rely on his own ingenuity. He didn't rely on his own efforts, his own strength to live out the goals and the assignments, amen, and the accomplishments that were so much a part of his life. He completely relied on the power, a power that was beyond his human ability. A power that empowered and equipped him to be and to do what he did. He was the firstborn of many brethren. He had the help of the Holy Spirit. He was born by the Spirit. He was baptized in the Spirit. He was anointed with the Spirit. He was resurrected by the power of the Spirit. Look at John 1:14. Praise the Lord. And the Word was made flesh and dwelt among us, and we beheld his glory, the glory as of the only begotten of the Father, full of grace and truth. That's who he was. That's what he was.
Yes.
Praise God. He operated by the power of the Spirit, which is the Spirit of grace. Everything that we were talking about here this morning is what God's really wanting us to comprehend. And more than comprehend, embrace it, live it.
Yes.
There's plenty of ways of saying it.
Yes.
This just happens to be the way I'm going to say it, amen? But there's all sorts of ways of explaining this, but it's how I understand it. So that's the only way I can explain it to you. But look, let's look again at John chapter 5, verse 19. This isn't just Jesus being humble. This is Jesus being honest. He is the truth. And he answered Jesus, then answered Jesus and said unto them, verily, verily, I say unto you, the Son can do nothing of himself. This human being that you're looking at can't do anything. But what he seeth the Father do. For whatsoever things soever that he doeth, these doeth the Son likewise. In other words, he says, I just rest in what God does. And that's what I believe. That's my reality.
Right.
By myself, I can't do any of this stuff that you're seeing, these miracles that you're witnessing. Every miracle that he performed was by the Spirit. Every miracle he performed was by the Spirit. And every temptation he overcame was made possible because of the Spirit. Not because he was more disciplined. Not because he was more sincere. Not because he was trying harder.
Right.
It was because of the Spirit, his reliance on the Spirit.
Right.
It's evident. We have elevated, and God forbid that I would demean Christ, but I'm saying we have elevated the man somehow and thinking that we can achieve these things through hard work. He couldn't do it. You can't either.
Right.
You have to depend on the Spirit. Regardless of what the confrontation is, whether it's a temptation or whether it's, you know, healing or a miracle or signs and wonders. It all happens by the Spirit. It doesn't happen by human flesh that's dedicated to wanting something.
That's right.
As a matter of fact, Jesus didn't do anything by himself. And he was the first one to admit it. His entire life was characterized by his reliance on the power of the Spirit. And that's the thing that has bugged me and troubled me from day one when I'd see ministers and, I'm not talking about males, I'm just talking about people in ministry that are giving the impression that they have done something that makes them more powerful than anybody else. It's bogus. If they have anything unique, it's that they understand something you just don't understand. If, in fact, it's real what they're doing. And if it's real, then it's just that they have embraced something that we're still standing around, kind of like the children of Israel when Moses went up the mountain. They said, you talk to him, he freaks us out. And so, not that was a kind of a cop-out, but at the same time, it made it possible for them to then later say when Moses would give them something God had spoken to him, well, it's just Moses. He's just a guy. We don't have to listen to him. That's why we need to be led by the Holy Spirit and not by men. Not by people, but by the Holy Spirit. When you're led by the Holy Spirit, you'll find a witness in other people. If they're believers, they'll acknowledge that. They'll recognize it. We see it all the time in our services, in the preliminaries especially. Some people get really whacked out about this. Think, my God, how long is this going to go on? Like my grandchildren. And what's the point in all of this? Well, the point is, we actually think the Holy Spirit's going to say something through somebody, and then it will be validated or confirmed by another witness.
Right.
And it happens. Is everything, directly a word from God? No, but we can't risk not listening that what might be. If we have a body, I've been in churches where they have this designated group of people that do the praying. They've got their badge and they've been picked out as the spiritual. And, okay, I understand it in a way because they're afraid of chaos. I'm not really afraid of chaos. I think God is greater than whatever confusion us humans can create. But when you limit the prayers to 8 people or 6 people or 5 people and the prophetic work of God to 4 or 5 people, you've just limited God to 4 or 5 people when you've got 50 people or 30 people or 500 people, when God maybe is speaking to somebody that we don't really necessarily want to hear from. I've heard as much profoundness in terms of God, from people that I really didn't want to hear from. I didn't really want to listen to. I didn't have respect for them as another person. I know that makes me sound really horrible, but I'm human. I need the Holy Ghost, praise the Lord.
Yes.
But God speaks through people because that's his avenue of approach. That's how he does it.
Right.
You know, I was watching something, I don't know if it was on TV or something, but there was this Hollywood producer, and the guy wasn't very good looking, and well, because that's just my opinion, so, but he had this gorgeous wife. I mean, she was beautiful. And I told Sally, I said, you know, it's unfair that the biggest jerks in the world catch the most beautiful wives. I mean, does anybody else ever see that? And Sally just smiled and said, well, thank you, dear. Yeah, thank you, dear. So, praise the Lord. And just in case you're not following my logic here, if Jesus relied on and depended on the Holy Spirit to be Jesus, then we need the Spirit's help to live this manifested life of Christ in you, the hope of glory. So in John 16, the first thing Jesus tells his disciples, he has to leave and return to the Father. And then in verse 7, if you can bring it up, is it up there? Nevertheless, I tell you the truth, it's expedient for you that I go away. For if I go not away, the Comforter will not come unto you. But if I depart, I will send him unto you.
Right.
So Jesus knows what the disciples don't know.
Right.
That they won't be able to carry out the mission that he's given them without having the power that he relied on to do his own work.
Sure.
He relied on this because he didn't have the ability in and of himself.
Right.
He taught them for 3.5 years. But because of his knowledge and his wisdom and his understanding, he knew that information and education wasn't going to be enough. They needed the Holy Ghost. They needed to operate by the Spirit the same way he did. Acts chapter 1, verses 4 and 5. Being assembled together with them, commanded them that they should not depart from Jerusalem, but wait for the promise of the Father, which saith he, ye have heard of me. For John truly baptized with water, but you will be baptized with the Holy Ghost not many days hence. So being filled with the Holy Spirit isn't necessarily how much of the Spirit you have. And I know this is cliche, but it's still true. It's really about how much of the Holy Spirit has you. What happens when we see what we see in a church service or in manifestations isn't like a unique, unusual, one-of-a-kind thing that God does. It's what God has done all along. It's what God has already done. It's just us being aware for a little while of more of God than we are at other times.
Right.
So it isn't about how much Holy Ghost you get and people being refilled and refilled and so on and so forth, but it's about how much of him has you.
Right.
In other words, what I mean is, fire you and hire him.
Yes.
You aren't going to get it done. And he's already done it.
Yes.
Praise the Lord. There's a tendency to drift into works of righteousness. And Jesus dealt with it. Paul dealt with it. You see it all throughout the New Covenant. In fact, in Galatians chapter 3, let's look at that in verses 1 through 3. Very familiar, but let's look at it in this context. I don't know what these people were trying to do, but I'm guessing they were trying to do what Jesus had done and what they had seen the apostles do.
Yeah.
Cast out demons.
Yeah.
Heal the sick.
Yeah.
Amen? Do those things. The things that we talk about, right? Oh, foolish Galatians, who's bewitched you that you should not obey the truth? Before whose eyes Jesus Christ has been evidently set forth, crucified among you. This only would I learn of you. Receive ye the Spirit by the works of the law, or by your own energy and effort, or by the hearing of faith? Are you so foolish, having begun in the Spirit, are you now made perfect by the flesh? You're not going to get it done in and of yourself. It can't happen. It can only happen when we yield to the Holy Spirit. They were trying to finish in their own strength what had been started by the power of the Spirit.
Amen. Amen.
What happens in churches over and over and over and in individual lives. God started it, and God wants to finish it. John 15:5. I'm the vine, you're the branches. He that abideth in me and I in him, the same bringeth forth much fruit. For without me, you can't do anything. You have to abide. You have to be conscious and aware and focused on the vine, not on the branch. The branch is just where the fruit appears.
Right.
Without the vine, there's no branch.
Right.
The branch can't do anything without the vine.
Right.
Our job is to surrender. Our job is to yield, or another word is to rest. And the Holy Spirit will work in you and through you, just like it did in Jesus. And it won't work in any other way, because that's the only way it works.
Yes.
Let me show you. Look at Genesis chapter 6 and verse 8. We'll go clear, way back. First man God declared to be righteous, Noah. Was Noah any better than everybody else? The only difference between Noah and everybody else, and the reason God declared him to be righteous, because he had a pure bloodline. He hadn't, it hadn't intermingled with the mixture of, and I don't want to get off into another teaching here, but with a mixture of the Nephilims and the, you know, the fallen angels that the scripture talks about, showing themselves as men and then intermarrying and having intercourse and so forth with human beings, and then the offspring were, they were a mess.
Right.
And they had disrupted the entire bloodline. Remember, God's intent from day one was to have a people through whom he could finally come into the earth at the appointed time.
Right.
So if the bloodlines are messed, he's not coming.
Right.
So that was the reason for the destruction. It wasn't that God just got mad one day and decided, I'm just going to mess this thing up and start all over again. It was because it was down to just a handful of people who still had pure human blood, Adamic blood. Amen? So Noah found grace in the eyes of the Lord. Noah was declared righteous by God, not because of his behavior, not because of anything he'd done or not done, but simply because of who he was, because of his bloodline. We've been born again from above. We have a new DNA. It's the DNA of God that now is in us. Christ in you, the hope of glory. He said Noah found grace. How did he find grace? Noah's name means rest. You can look it up in the concordances, and in the one that I have, it's the original is 146, and then it is also in 51:18, and the name means rest.
Mm-hmm.
Noah found grace in the eyes of God by resting in his declaration over him that you're righteous, you're the righteousness of God. Noah just rested in that. I mean, you got to figure, it was pretty confusing to him too, because he knew his life.
Yeah.
He knew he wasn't perfect.
Right.
And yet God chose him out of all these people.
Right.
To do what? To be a manifestation, because after all, the ark, we know it's a type of Christ. You know, Noah didn't shut the door. God shut it. It was above. It wasn't on the sides. And, you know, you go into all that teaching, but I'm just saying, if that's how God started, you think of the, I don't remember now what it's exactly called, but it's like the law of first truths. When you read something in the Bible for the first time, then you have to use that context whenever you look at it on down the road, because God's trying to tell you something.
Yes.
Well, here we have the first context really for righteousness in a human who was not righteous in his own works, unlike Enoch, who walked with God and then wasn't and so forth because he found favor, but I'm saying this guy was a mess just like everybody else was, but God declared him righteous because of his bloodline. And then, you know, his name, his very name, tells us that it was because of rest that God was able to use it.
Yes.
Of resting in what God's declaration was. Amen?
Yes.
So if the church is going to be effective in our world, then we're going to need to just, you know, stop paying lip service to the Spirit and recapture the biblical perspective that God has given us. Look at Genesis chapter 1, verses 1 through 3. Familiar to everybody, it's the first verses in the scripture, but I think it's contextual here, because in the beginning God created the heaven and the earth was without form and void, and darkness was upon the face of the deep, and the Spirit of God, same Holy Spirit that we have, moved upon the face of the waters.
Come on.
And God said, let there be light, and there was light. Now look at Genesis chapter 2, verses 1 and 2.
In the beginning, God created an earth. Okay, that's not it, but here we go. Thus the heavens and the earth were finished, and the host of them, and the seventh day God ended his work, which he had made, and he rested on the seventh day from all his work which he had made. We are in the Sabbath rest. We are in Christ. He is the Sabbath. He's Lord of the Sabbath.
Yes.
Telling me we ought to be resting instead of working. We ought to be resting in the work that he has already finished. Jesus said, it is finished. That's where the power is, church. Not in us, in the finished work of Christ, in the finished work of God Almighty. It's already done. We rest in it, and the Spirit makes it manifest, amen, through us. Hallelujah. By believing. See, the empowerment comes by grace, and it's by faith that we receive it. Faith is how you get manifestation. Believe, not faith like I just work up a bunch of faith. Faith is just simply believing in what he said.
Yeah.
Believe his word.
Glory.
And it'll come to pass. It's no hard work for you. You don't have to grunt and groan. You don't have to shout. You don't have to jump up and down. You can do all of that if you want to, but you don't have to.
Right.
You just lay hands on the sick and they recover.
There you go.
You just speak and light appears. Where there was darkness, where the enemy was, God shows up. Spirit is the experience, empowering return of God's own personal presence in us and among us. You've got to allow God to empower you. You've got a free will. So you have to allow him. God, the scripture says that we have limited God because of our human traditions. Sometimes religious, sometimes other. But imagine that. God has given us such authority here that we can limit his power. We can limit what God does in the earth by our own ignorance. Or stubbornness, or bullheadedness, or just outright, you know, hatefulness. 1 Corinthians chapter 4, verses 7 and 8. For who maketh thee to differ from another? What hast thou that didst not receive? Now, if thou didst receive it, why dost thou glory, as if thou hadst not received it? Now ye are full. Now ye are rich. He's talking about people filled with the Spirit. You're rich. You're full. You have reigned as kings without us. And Paul said, I would to God you did reign, that we also might reign with you.
Yes.
In other words, embrace this reality. Be who God says you are. You've already got it all.
Yes, Lord.
And we want to experience it with you.
Yes.
Come on.
Revelation chapter 1, verses 5 and 6. And from Jesus Christ, who is the faithful witness and the first begotten of the dead, the prince of the kings of the earth, unto him that loved us and washed us from our sins in his own blood, and hath made us kings and priests unto God and his Father, to him be glory and dominion forever and ever. Amen.
Yes.
Praise the Lord. Now, I'm going to use a metaphor. Some of you have heard me do this before, but it's appropriate here, so I'm going to repeat myself. It's not won't be the first time nor the last, but how many of you have ever played checkers? Okay, thank you, Peter. Him and you, apparently you two played with one another. Hallelujah. But the vital strategy in checkers is to get kinged. Because then your chances of winning increase. You have a new reality. You're able to move in ways that you couldn't move before. You can do things you couldn't do before. And you can do it with more freedom than you ever had before. And the same is true spiritually. When we get kinged in life by Jesus, we advance more freely.
Yes.
We have more power.
Yes.
All power is given unto me. Go ye therefore.
Yes.
You've been kinged.
Yes.
You become greater in terms of your threat to the enemy.
Yes.
You know, first we know Jesus is king. Just tells us that. Second, we have to acknowledge him as king. And third, and just as importantly, we have to live a life like we've been kinged.
Come on.
Yes.
There it is.
You're the righteousness of God in Christ. And he wants to completely reshape and reconstruct the way you understand yourself. That was the difference between Jesus, the man, and everybody else that was on this planet at that time. In fact, he was filled with the Holy Spirit, but the fact that he knew God's will for mankind. In checkers, once you're kinged, it means another checker piece has been put on top of yours. And that gives you power to move and to do what one checker by itself could not do. The Holy Spirit. When you get under what God has placed over you, you can get over what God has placed under you.
Come on.
The enemy's defeated.
Yes.
Romans 14, 17. The kingdom of God is not meat and drink, but righteousness, peace, and joy in the Holy Ghost. The kingdom of God is the reign of the king. Or, you could say it another way, it's the king's way. There's another scripture that says, seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things are added to you. One translation of that is, seek you the kingdom of God and God's way of doing things, and all of these things that he's promised manifest for you. John 14, this is a scripture, John 14, 12 through 20. John 14, 12 through 20. Verily, verily, I say unto you, he that believeth on me, the works that I do shall he do also. And greater works than these shall he do, because I go unto my Father.
Yes.
Whatsoever ye shall ask in my name, that will I do, that the Father may be glorified in the Son. If ye shall ask anything in my name, I will do it. If you love me, keep my commandments. And I will pray the Father, and he shall give you another comforter, that he may abide with you. And by the way, the only commandment we have is to love one another.
Amen.
I will pray the Father, and he'll give you another comforter, that he may abide with you forever, even the Spirit of truth, whom the world cannot receive, because it seeth him not, neither knoweth him. But you know him, for he dwelleth with you and shall be in you. I will not leave you comfortless. I will come to you. Yet a little while, and the world seeth me no more. But you see me, because I live, ye shall live also. At that day, you shall know that I am in my Father, and ye in me, and I in you.
Yes.
Back to the oneness again.
Yes. Yes.
Praise the Lord. So, Jesus kings us with the Holy Spirit,
mm-hmm.
so that we recapture our dominion, our inheritance, the kingdom. We are apprehended, as Paul said, so that we may apprehend. Praise the Lord. We've been kinged that we may live our lives out as kings who rule and reign with Christ. Give him a hand this morning. Praise God. Thank you, Lord. Amen. God bless you. I just encourage you, live this life in Christ. Keep the focus on Jesus. And as it was already said here and well said, that's how we remain one. That's how we stay one mind and one accord. We are all one in Christ.
Amen.
Hallelujah. Amen. God bless all of you. Have a great week. Enjoy the brief warm-up that we're going to have, and keep on keeping on for Jesus. Hallelujah.
Amen.
You're dismissed in his matchless name. Praise God.